Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Welcome to our service today as we celebrate the goodness of God to us, through us, and with us in Jesus Christ. Those of you who are in person, thank you for celebrating with us together physically. Those of you who are joining us online, we welcome you and thank you for participating in our worship today with us. Before we begin the service, just have a couple of announcements to share, and then we'll get right into it. In the bulletin, the online bulletin as well as the physical bulletin, there is an announcement this coming Saturday at the Riverside Park Pavilion in Findlay. There will be a memorial and vigil, prayer vigil, for those who have suffered through an overdose. And it's an overdose awareness event. We have, we've all been struggling with all kinds of things over the last year and a half, and struggles with depression and sickness and addiction have been a part of all of that. So everyone is invited and encouraged to participate. That begins, I believe, at 3 o'clock on Saturday. Yes, Saturday at Riverside Park, the band shall there, and please consider your participation in that. We do have some upcoming events, calendar events here at St. Luke's for the Bible school year. So please keep your attention to the September newsletter and updates as we go back to a more familiar routine with our Christian education. Are there any other announcements for the good of the community? All right, are asked this morning to pray for one of our friends over at St. John's in McComb. Her name is Pat. She was recently diagnosed with a very serious illness. So we lift Pat up in our prayers for the people today. Are there any other people who should be added to our prayer list today? And those of you who are watching online, if you want to post someone or a situation you want to pray for, please feel free to put that in the comments. All right, with that, we begin our service with our prelude and time for silent prayer and meditation. Peace of the Lord be with you.
So with you.
Please share with one another a sign of God's peace. 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 The Bible tells us that once we have shared the peace, we may come before God's holy place and make an offering, make our offerings. And our offerings, our first offering of the day, having shared the peace, is an offering of confession. Please, blessed be the Holy Trinity, the one God, who was in the beginning, who makes a dwelling among us, who covers us with justice and mercy. Amen. Please join me in the invitation to confession. If I claim that I have no fears, no guilt, no grief, or no regrets, I am lying to myself as stumbling around in the dark. There are times when the Holy Spirit calls my heart, but I worry more about what I have lost and fear what I might lose. I am not persuaded to follow God's calling. But the Lord makes this promise to me. If I come clean and admit that I have missed opportunities to love and serve others, God will faithfully and justly forgive me. Please take a moment and either silently or even in a small prayer, confess your fears, your guilt, greed, or regrets. Let us pray. God of power and might, you continually form my body and soul together into a masterpiece. In my fear and anger, I forget that others are your masterpiece too. Your abundant mercy and steadfast love restore me to new life. Thank you for cleaning out the dirty laundry of my life. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life, who feeds the hungry soul. Amen. We lift up our praise and thanksgiving to God.
Thank you. families whose ancestors worshiped when they lived on the other side of the Euphrates River and in Egypt. But if you don't want to worship the Lord, then choose right now. Will you worship the same idols your ancestors did? Or since you're living on the land that once belonged to the Amorites, maybe you worship their gods. I won't. My family and I are going to worship and obey the Lord. The people answered, we could never worship other gods or stop worshiping the Lord. The Lord is our God. We were slaves in Egypt, as our ancestors had been. But we saw the Lord work miracles to set our people free and to bring us out of Egypt. Even though other nations were all around us, the Lord protected us wherever we went. And when we fought Amorites and the other nations that lived in this land, the Lord made them run away. Yes, we will worship and obey the Lord because the Lord is God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
And now a reading from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 20. A final word, be strong in the Lord and in the Lord's mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against all strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor so that you will be able to resist the enemy in time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all these, hold on up the shield of faith to stop the fire arrows of the devil. Put on salvation as your helmet, and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. And pray for me too. Ask God to give me the right words so I can boldly explain God's mysterious plan that the good news is for Jews and Gentiles alike. I am in chains now, still preaching this message as God's ambassador. So pray that I will keep on speaking boldly for him as I should. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel acclamation and reading.
You cannot have eternal life within you. But anyone who eats
eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise that person on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Anyone who eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him. I live because of the living Father who sent me. In the same way, anyone who feeds on me will live because of me. Many of his disciples said, "This is very hard to understand. How can anyone accept it?" Jesus was aware that his disciples were complaining, so he said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what will you think if you see the Son of Man ascend to heaven again? The Spirit alone gives eternal life. Human effort accomplishes nothing. And the very words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But some of you do not believe me. For Jesus knew from the beginning which ones didn't believe, and he knew who would betray him. Then he said, that is why I said that people can't come to me unless the Father gives them to me." At this point, many of his disciples turned away and deserted him. Then Jesus turned to the 12 and asked, "Are you also going to leave?" Simon Peter replied, "Lord, to whom would we go? You have the words that give eternal life." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please join me in reciting the words of our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Those of you who are joining us online and aren't sure what the Apostles' Creed says, all you have to say is, "I believe in God the Creator, I believe in God the Savior, and I believe in God the Forgiver of sins." I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Before we begin reflection, the sermon today, if you would join me in reading, going to page 5 in your bulletin, join me in reading Ephesians chapter 6, verses 18 through 20. In the printed bulletin, it is the last paragraph on the page. Page 5, Ephesians in the bulletin, Ephesians chapter 6, verses 18 through 20. On page 5, it is the last full paragraph on the page. Pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. And pray for me too. Ask God to give me the right words so I can boldly explain God's mysterious plan that the good news is for Jews and Gentiles alike. I am in chains now, still preaching this message as God's ambassador. So pray that I will keep on speaking boldly for him as I should. Just prior to worship today, I asked for our friend Jolynn some help in finding some very important items of faith. Jolynn works with our food ministry and works with in the kitchen, and she was very helpful. So she was able to guide me in the right direction to find some, again, very important objects of faith. The first thing that she found for me was a helmet, the helmet of salvation. And as we looked around some more, she found for me a special breastplate, a breastplate of righteousness. discovered some gloves of peace. Now, I'm not very good with putting gloves on, so I may just have to put one. So I'll have half the peace with me. And then we discovered and found the shield of faith. And finally, as we were going through, a sword of the Spirit. Now, these items listed here in today's discipleship reading are items that Paul tells us are important for us as people of faith in a world where we are seeking peace, in a world where we are seeking truth, in a world where we are seeking righteousness, in a world where we are seeking salvation. The Apostle Paul presents for us items and objects, things that enable us as the people of faith to cope and respond to a world that often seems chaotic, filled with struggle, both not just victory, but also personal struggle, personal loss, and defeat. Now, one of the important things to remember is that while we have these objects of faith, this shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit and this helmet of salvation, that these represent the things of the supernatural. These are unlike any other weapons that the natural world can produce. And so the Apostle Paul is reminding us today of these wonderful, powerful, supernatural weapons. Most of you know that I spent the last 2 weeks visiting my brother down in Florida. And one of the reasons I love visiting Florida is because, unlike Ohio, there's an ocean. And there are nice beaches. And for maybe 330 days of the year, you can go to that ocean and those beaches and enjoy just sitting and watching the water, feeling the sun, the breezes, getting sand in between your toes. And this was no different. I had the opportunity on a few occasions to be able to spend the day at the beach. And it was just a wonderful moment to be able to just kind of sit there and to see and feel all the elements, to feel the warm sun, to feel the sand between my toes, to hear the waves crashing on the shoreline, to hear parents watching their children play and laugh in the sand and the water. I was fortunate enough, just before I traveled to Florida, that a friend of mine gave me a little devotional book that's called something like Devotions for the Beach. It was a coincidence. I don't think that friend knew where I was traveling, but it just seemed appropriate, so I packed that devotional book with me so that I would have it with me to spend some time in prayer while I was at the beach. And I discovered that as I was praying, I caught myself into a little rhythm. I put my mind and my hearing into the sound of the waves crashing, that constant rhythm of the waves crashing on the shoreline. And as I was reading the devotional and just kind of getting myself into that meditative, prayerful moment on the beach, I started to pray each time a wave crashed on the shore. I don't know whether or not that was planned, but it just happened that way. I figured that maybe this is the way that the Spirit was calling me to pray. And so each time that the wave crashed on the shoreline, I would offer a prayer based on the devotion that I had just read in that moment. As I got deeper into my meditation, as I got deeper into my own reflecting and my own conversation with God, I noticed that I had a pattern. That whenever I was praying in those moments, it wasn't so much prayers for me or prayers for things going on with me. It was mostly prayers for other people. And what I mean by prayers for other people, it was prayers for people or situations that were going on in my life that were causing me distress, causing me to struggle, causing anxiety, stirring up anger, stirring up regret, stirring up a sense of loss. And so that whenever I was praying, each time a wave rolled in and crashed on the shore, the prayer wasn't so much for me, it was that I was praying for the other person, or I was praying for the situation, that it would change so that I wouldn't feel the pain. My prayers kept blaming people for my struggle. My prayers kept going back to my regrets and bringing back my shame and wanting the situation to just simply end so that I wouldn't feel that pain. To kind of put it in ways that the Apostle Paul put it in today. Whereas prayer is a way for us to find a connection with God, connection with the Spirit, a way for us to open up our hearts and our spirits so that we might have God and the Spirit enter into our hearts and our souls, and to provide us with the kind of answer or response or comfort that we need. Instead of seeing prayer or using the prayer as a way to build up my strength, I was simply using prayer like that sword of faith and taking swings at everything that was making me upset or hurt. Whenever I teach Bible study leaders in churches and congregations how to lead Bible study or to give a format for Bible study, one of the things that I instruct is that you take a moment and read the passage and decide whether or not the passage is a promise, God promising something, or whether it's a teaching, God giving us some detail about the nature or the character of God, or whether it is a command that helps us better understand how to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, or to love our neighbor as we have been loved by God. And from my standpoint, today's discipleship reading is clearly a command. More specifically, a command in how we use our prayers. Because the supernatural power of faith, the supernatural power of truth, the supernatural power of salvation, the supernatural power of righteousness is more powerful than any tank ever built, more powerful than any fighter plane ever fought, more powerful than any machine gun or hand grenade that has ever been built. The supernatural is the power, what drives us in how we understand and relate to our world. Do we have anybody who's a veteran, was in the military? Yeah. Did they, when you went to the front lines, did they give you a broom to fight off the enemy? Was your helmet a colander? Was your breastplate a piece of plastic? That's the way that God looks at our faith. And God looks at the truth. And that God looks at salvation. That when we use prayer simply to attack the people that upset us, simply to go after the situation, simply as a way to produce our own self-righteousness, then we have used the supernatural power of faith that is inappropriate for a world that desperately needs to hear good news. One of the things that I've learned over the years about the power of Satan, the power of the devil, is that the devil has that supernatural power, just like God has that supernatural power. The key difference is that he has the natural mind, works only in the natural ways of doing things, takes prayer and uses prayer as a weapon, takes worship and uses worship as a weapon, takes the things that are of the supernatural and use them against the people that make us afraid. And today, Paul is giving us a command. Paul is trying to let us know about loving God and loving others. That these supernatural weapons, these supernatural powers, are meant to grow faith. and more specifically meant to grow our faith. In today's reading, Paul doesn't pray that the chains are loosened. He doesn't pray that the natural power be slipped away, though he has every right to pray that his chains and his imprisonment would change. Paul doesn't pray death to the guards or death to the government that has put him in prison, though he has every right to be able to do that. What he prays for is the supernatural power of strength and boldness to keep proclaiming the good news. And that is our call for us today, to think about the ways that we use our prayer and to think about the ways that we use our worship. Does it attempt to attack and go after, or is it used simply to grow our own strength so that we can share that strength with the people around us? You know, immigrants are not our enemies. Poverty is our enemy. Addiction, people who sell drugs, they're not the enemies. Depression and that inner struggle, that's the enemy. People who do crazy things, they're not the enemies, they're our neighbors. It is the regret, it is the greed, it is the anger, those are the enemies. And today, Paul instructs us that the first people we pray for is for ourselves. That in any situation that's giving us struggle, the way to victory, the way to resurrection, is to simply say, Lord, where is the strength that I have to meet this day? It's great, it's wonderful that we pray for those who need healing. We pray for family and friends. But today, Paul calls us not only to pray for the healing of others, but that we would also heal others. It's great that we address issues like racism, but it's not enough to pray for the racists. It's that we pray that we ourselves do not contribute to racism. You know, we saw those pictures earlier this week of people trying, clinging to a C-130 airplane. And we sit there and in amazement and shock and horror. And for some of us, it reminded us of another war that ended badly. We pray for the people of Afghanistan. We pray for our military. But if we truly want peace, we have to start praying for peace to emerge in our own hearts. That we pray for the strength of peace. And we begin to act and ask God how we act, and then act out of that. So take a moment this week. Think about the ways that you pray. Think about the ways that you worship. Are you worshiping and are you praying to get rid of your anger or your fear or your greed or your regret? Or are you praying that the helmet of salvation and the breastplate of righteousness and the sword of the Spirit and the shoes of peace, that those are being grown and sown in your own spirit, your own heart, and then shared and expressed with the people around you? Let the people of God say, Amen. quickly have some offerings of thanksgiving to you here at St. John or at St. Luke's, but also at St. John's. I was just very grateful for Tammy a couple weeks ago, and then last week Olivia coming and preaching for us. Also for the worship leaders that kind of stepped up to the task, filled the gap, and led worship, led the other parts of the worship service. I know that Tammy's video had been taken off. We can't watch her preaching. Olivia, though, is still up, and you should really have a look at it. She did a marvelous job, and those of you who were here know that. But my gratitude for the congregations for leading worship, keeping worship going here over the last 2 weeks. Thank you so much also for being very good and very kind hosts. I didn't doubt that would be a problem, but it's always good to thank graciousness. So thank you so much for supporting both of them, both Tammy for the work that she's doing and Olivia for nurturing her faithfulness in our midst. I also want to thank everyone. I know here in person, most of you are wearing masks, and I don't want to belabor or spend a whole lot of time on this, but I do appreciate that. That is actually an offering of kindness to not only to ourselves, but to our neighbors. When I was in Florida, they are struggling in Florida to figure out what to do with mask mandates, and oftentimes it is local businesses and local people who have to kind of make rules because the government isn't really very as responsive. They're not trying to cooperate with local communities very well. And so I had been in a business that asked me to wear a mask, and I walked out. Of course, you know, why not celebrate the good times? I forgot to take the mask off like we were in lockdown before. But as I was walking along, a car drove along and slowed down and yelled at me to take my mask off. And so I know that mask wearing is uncomfortable. We're getting more used to it, but it's still a struggle physically. And sometimes there are even people who kind of challenge why we're wearing them. I just want to thank you as a part of our own stewardship for wearing the mask for whatever reason. Thank you for doing that. We're planning on continuing in-person worship because we know that the infection rate is on the rise. But for now, there aren't really any plans other than to just keep doing what we're doing. And thank you for helping us continue to be in-person by wearing masks. I also want to thank everyone who's just continued to help continue the work and the mission of St. John's and St. Luke's. Monetary contributions, physical help, donations of items, and so forth. Again, just thank you very much for your continued support of our ministries. Thank everyone online as well for your contributions as well. If you have any questions about how you can help, or if there are any new ideas you think that we can do as we, again, try to figure out what our life is like together, entering into the next phase of the pandemic, please feel free to share ideas, to ask questions if you're not sure about how to support the work that we're doing. With that, let us now pray together the prayers of the people. May children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of courage, bless leaders of your church. Make them ready to proclaim the gospel of peace and strengthen them to preach your loving word. We especially lift up our national bishop, Bishop Eaton, as well as our local bishop, Bishop Bowden. We lift up our friends and family in faith in the Mwanamota Lutheran Parish in Tanzania. We thank you, God, so much for our pastors, our deacons, our elders, church councils, committees, and ministry team leaders who continue to work and find ways to share good news in their neighborhoods. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of creation, bless fields and orchards, protect the land from drought, and bring life-giving rain to Instruct your people in wise treatment of the world you have provided for all your creatures. We are especially mindful, Lord God, of people who are struggling with the destruction of wildfires, Lord, people who are preparing for hurricanes and tropical storms, and we continue to remember the people of Haiti, whose plight we were graciously blessed to hear from Tammy, as they continue to recover from an earthquake and from tropical storms. Lord God, as we live and breathe and exist and share your word, continue to strengthen and grow our wisdom and knowledge in ways that we can continue to provide sustainable life on the planet. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of community, bless all who seek justice between nations and peoples. Give guidance to bridge builders, heal divisions, and inspire cooperation in times of crisis, disaster, and war. Lord God, we are especially mindful of the people of Afghanistan, our troops and military leaders. And Lord God, in the midst of the things that we don't understand, in the midst of the things that make us feel helpless, enable us, Lord God, to use our prayers so that we might find our own healing and strength to do what you call us to do, to bring peace in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of compassion, bless all who are in any need. Accompany all who are lonely and feeling abandoned, and remind them of your abiding presence. Accompany all who are persecuted and exploited, and open us to their cries. In this week, when our community is preparing for remembering those family, friends, and caregivers of those who have overdosed, Lord God, help us be mindful of those who are struggling with depression and addiction. Enable us, Lord God, to take the time to be mindful and with gentle, kind prayers, open our hearts and minds so that we may find ways to be healers of those who are struggling with depression. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of change, bless our transitions. Guide all who are embarking on stages, new stages in life, such as a new job, new school, or a new community. Sustain enduring friendships and kindle new relationships and interests. Lord God, we are especially mindful of our schools, our teachers, students, parents, administrators, and staff, all who work hard to make the school year a blessing to our community. Lord God, we thank you for the teachers and administrators in our own congregations. We ask God for blessings upon those who are going to college and entering post-high school work and college for the first time. In the midst of transition, Lord God, we ask for blessings upon St. Luke's and St. John's as we figure out what the future is that you call us to be and to become. And Lord God, in the wisdom of this prayer, sustain our congregations, enduring friendships, and kindle new relationships and interests. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we lift before you today members of our families and friends in need of your care. We especially remember today John, Marilyn, Bob, Bertha and Jim, Barb, Jack and Donna, Gloria, Rex, Jim, Sue, Larry, Francis, Ed, Beth, Zach, Brent, Richard, Christine, Lauren, Deanna, Laura, Michael, Jason, Cindy, Sally, Catherine, Carol, Janae, John, Gary, Paul and Sue, Linda, Luann, Colleen, Eva, Betty, Braxton, Eric and Lisa, Brenda, Cindy, Pat, Arlene, and those that we name before you in our hearts and through our voices. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of comfort, bless all who mourn the deaths of their loved ones. We especially remember this day the family of Joanne Allard. We give you thanks for the saints who have gone before us. Renew our confidence in your promise of resurrection and life in the world to come. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come,
Your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
In today's gospel reading, we are reminded of the struggle that the early followers of Jesus had in understanding the difference between the power, the supernatural power of God's prayer and worship life, and the natural powers that stir up anxiety, fear, and hopelessness. And so Jesus, trying to help his disciples better understand why he came to earth and what his death and resurrection would mean, provided us with a wonderful, not just symbol, but a wonderful presence of God's life with us, the bread, the wine, and the Spirit together. So as we celebrate the work of faith, the work of the supernatural in our own natural lives, let us praise God together, singing the Holy, Holy, Holy. Some of us gathered here today are not comfortable or receiving the sacrament directly, and those of you online may not be in a position to share the elements with one another. So please, if you feel or so moved, please join me in the spiritual communion prayer if you cannot participate using the bread and the wine. Forgiving and faithful God, I believe that you are present in the most blessed and holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my heart and spirit. Since I cannot now receive you through bread and wine, come spiritually into my heart. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a forgiving spirit within me. Amen. This time, we are ready to receive.
Thank you.
Through the body, blood, and spirit of Jesus Christ, I am not condemned by my angry, fearful actions. My sins are forgiven, forgotten, and erased. This is God's promise to me. Free from the shackles of my own guilt and regret, I have been given the strength to reconcile with those I have hurt and forgive those who have hurt me. Amen. Today, the Spirit sent you to hear good news from Jesus, the bread of life. Now you are being sent into a world that often demands your own blood, sweat, and tears. As you go, take this word and offer your neighbors, friends, and family the bread and spirit that give eternal life. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. And all God's people say,
thanks be to God.